So, what are my thoughts on A Tribe Called Quest's fourth album, Beats, Rhyme, and Life? Stay tuned. What's going on, ladies and gents in Cyberland? Coming back to you with another album review for hip-hop group A Tribe Called Quest. So, with Beats, Rhyme, and Life, I bought this album and a love movement. Or, I'm sorry, the love movement. And I didn't listen to either one for a long time. And particularly the reason why I didn't was because I was so immersed in the first three albums that I just felt like I felt like complete. And I'm an album person, I'm not a singles person. I just felt like, was there anything else that they could offer me at that point? I just was like full. Like, you know when you eat like a good meal that they keep bringing you food, but you're just like, nah, I don't want nothing. It was just, I just, like, that's one thing I loved about the first three Tribe albums is that I got the fulfillment, especially the more I sat and listened to them, the more I had them in my catalog. So finally, when I got around to Beats, Rhyme, and Life, I always knew something was different about this album. And especially because the love movement, because the group was inevitably, they broke up. So when I sat down and listened to the album, right when the track starts off with Phony Rappers, I could already tell something was different about the music. It just didn't have the same vibe that the last three albums had, the instrumentation behind it. And honestly, looking back on it now, I wholeheartedly believe that was not necessarily because of Q-Tip or the group. I think what had happened was, and this is a totally left field situation, but I think this album is it was the beginning of where hip hop could no longer do what they were doing before. It was two elements. The first one was Beastie Boys' Paul Boutique. I remember reading an article that was probably one of the few albums that had the most hip samples all crafted into one album. And because, even though the album wasn't a huge success because it was coming off of License to Ill and people were expecting a License to Ill album, they didn't get that, it was ignored. However, it's credited as one of the greatest hip-hop albums of all time. But everything that was incorporated on that album, I don't think technically got clearance, or there was some issue with it that it went to court. And everything that came after, or I think the ripple effect of it, was that either the companies that own the catalogs are going to charge huge amounts of money to use even a 10-second sample from a song, or 30 seconds, or whatever. Or some type of politics with getting points on that song, or points on the album, and points is, I believe, I've learned that from their Nevermind when they were doing a documentary. But I guess points has to do with how much, if the person had any part of making the album, they get a paycheck every for the album or something like that, but it's not one time, it's like repeated or something. And that was the one thing. And the other thing was that artists were going to have to, their budget, meaning if they didn't have the money to sample what they want to sample, you know, because samples could, depending on what it is, the sample could be, your album could cost you $1 million because you had all these little tiny samples to make these tracks. And you might have And then if the album doesn't sell, you're in the, you know, that whole business side of it. So I think moving towards the late 90s, you had a lot more artists not sampling and coming up with their own beats and sounds. And to some degree, it worked. However, to another degree, the some of the stuff that came out was just... Lyrically, you had artists that had great songs and great albums. But then on the other hand, some of the stuff was just not very good. And when I get to Wu-Tang, and I remember it's like the documentary of A Tribe Called Quest. It was one thing that Questlove said. The last golden age of hip-hop was Wu-Tang Clan, Inner 36 Chambers, and Midnight Marauders. And you know what? A long time, I was like, yeah, I see what you're saying. But now, when I'm thinking about it from a sample retrospect, he's got a point. Because everything that came after those two albums, the sampling had really gone down. Like, not subpar, just they weren't using it. So, I think that's one of the elements for this album. We don't have those same type of samples that we had for the first three albums. And I think that was really because of things going on behind the scenes. I don't think it was necessarily Q-Tip didn't want to utilize it. Of course, this is my opinion, but looking at everything from a full perspective, I think that had some type of relevance to why the album sounded the way it did. And it's not a bad album. It's not my favorite on their six. However, it has good elements. Like my top tracks are The Pressure, Once Again, Love Once Again, Stressed Out, Motivators, and Phony Rappers. And people say this is the darkest Tribe album. I do have to agree with that. I think it is. I think it had, because this album came out in 96 and I wasn't paying attention to, you know, I'm in the rock. I'm over here. I'm in the rock area. I'm not really into the hip hop at the time. So I know the whole situation with the East Coast, West Coast was during this time. Noriega, Capone, Ice Cube, The West Side Connection, Common, Nas, Tupac, Jay-Z, Biggie, you had these people, you know, Snoop, you had these people going back and forth on both sides. And Tribe they weren't a part of either side. That's why they had the song in here. I forget which one it was. But they were just like, you know, I ain't got nothing, and we're doing music, we're not even involved with this. So, the elements of this album just were like, just dark, and then you had, I believe it was Consequence came in here, and a lot of people, I guess, felt a certain type of way. They felt it should have just been Q-Tip and Five, that Consequence, I think, let me see, because sometimes I forget names. Yeah, Consequence was like on here a lot, and a lot of people looking back felt a certain type of way. I was just like, I didn't have an issue with it because I'm coming in later listening to that. I'm not like people who first bought it and listened to it at Midnight Marauders. I'm coming in way later, so I didn't have an issue with it. However, apparently people did, and apparently when you watch the documentary too, there was a lot of issues. And you can now, and especially after watching the documentary, you can see it in the music. It shows. Again, it just didn't have that vibe like the first three albums. It felt like there was a break, like the puzzle was starting to come apart, you know? And then Faith Evans being on Stressed Out, that being the closing track, if you don't have the B-sides, it wasn't the same like A Low End Theory. It wasn't the same like Midnight Marauders. It wasn't the same like their first album. Hearing that song, and that song really strikes a chord with me. It's not my favorite. It's one of my top five, but not my number one. But it just, you just get this feeling like things are not with the group at this point. And maybe that song, out of all the songs, yeah, really kind of exhibit what these probably going on in the group and also inhibiting around them as a collective with Jive and the fans and just the whole atmosphere. It's a great song. It's just, you know, it does, for me, it gives that type of vibe. So for my rating for the album, and this was kind of difficult. It's not a 3, it's not a 5. I would give it a 4 out of 5 yes sirs. I would say, if you're a Tribe fan, then you know, you're going to listen to it. If you never listen to Tribe, I wouldn't suggest going here first. I would suggest the first 3. And then, you know, then if you, it's kind of like a history book almost. It's like where they started, where they went, and how they ended. It's like, that's how a Tribe Called Quest's albums are like a journey. It's like, you know, a dip and a resurrection, I guess you could say, for the music. So yeah, if you enjoyed the first 3 albums, you know, check out this 4th album. And there's some tracks in there I'm pretty sure you'll enjoy. However, would I say I rank it above the other first 3? I don't think so. I also don't like it at the bottom either. At the 6. So with that being said, let's cue the music. Drop four points, you know the transaction. Pay attention, run it till you get the abstract. It's in the house.
In this American metropolis, filled with MCs, a Tribe Called Quest came to drop jewels with ease, plus make you party. We do this music thing for everybody, black, white, Latino, and Asian. We co-raising the stakes of hip-hop to a new plateau, to bridge gaps of generations for future plantations. A God-fearing folk, cause we all from the yoke of one breed, one seed, to good goals we proceed. Nowadays, I strive to be a very good influence, even though not too long ago, I was a truant, now I'm dropping it on this and many broad topics, from man's obsession with money, the holy prophets like Muhammad. Yeah, you know the scene is so freaky. Enemies, they denounce me, and my own try to sweep me. Now I got hip-hop acts posing like fat cats. Lex and the...